that study is just for me to try to exist in more points within the middle of the Venn diagram between like everybody.
You have any preference, or I'm just gonna make what I make you?
You don't got no hazelnut.
Oh, come on, don't do me like that. I wish I did. All my syrups are back in DC, bro.
Bro, it's not my fault. I should have came to y'all.
Bro. You gave us an excuse to come out, so don't worry about that.
I'm glad y'all here, man. Thank y'all for being here. But other than that, bro, just, you know, little milk, little sugar, little, you know, make it cute for me. Regular day. Oh, yeah. Is this Be Healthy by Dead Prez?
Tell me about this song, bro. When's the first time you heard it?
Oh, man, the first time I heard Be Healthy by Dead Prez had to be, I was like a fucking three-year-old in 2004, Chevrolet Tahoe. Me and my mama and my daddy. My daddy's a, 22-year vegan now. So, and this whole album, bro, like, let's get free, bro.
So, I know that your dad is a producer, right?
Yeah, and a programmer and a carpenter. He's a polymath.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you, would you say that you got any influences from your dad in terms of like seeing his production style?
Yeah, to some extent, because he made like really Southern hip hop, like that was proud to be Southern and country, which I can appreciate. And then he regularly taught me like how to count four beats to a measure, what four take. Like when I joined like band class in sixth grade, I knew way more than them niggas just off the string. Even then, already taught me a lot of shit about music before it was like, before I could use it even, you know?
Yeah. So you started off in the marching band and then you did the switch to music.
Yeah, kind of. But I feel like all black children, like the same way all black children could play basketball a little bit, we could rap a little bit. So I was that kind of kid for sure.
With your dad, he's a computer programmer, right?
Yeah.
So the thing about computer programming is that it takes a lot of organization because mm-hmm. if anything slips out, the code's gone. Would you say that you, and listening to Let the Sun Talk, which we'll get into later, mm-hmm. it's really organized in a way that you have the intro setting kind of the thesis, and then it's organized in an essay fashion. Would you say that you got your critical thinking skills and your organization skills from watching your dad?
Oh, for sure, for sure. Like he's a programmer, he's a philosopher. So, man, we doing the important things. But what's the name? Yeah, like he always just challenged my ideas, and like he taught me a little bit of coding, like HTML, CSS. I can work my way around, right? And so like just having your whole shit fuck up, if there's one contradiction. That's something I honor highly, like, in trying to build out my little, like, life philosophy and shit like that. And yeah, like, for sure, all of that, bro. Like, the programming and the construction, he's just a builder. He's a synthesizer.
And, I like that.
And it's a logic to it, you know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
That matters a lot. But he's not so organized, and I'm not so organized, so even Let the Sun, to some extent, is organized in a macro sense, but on a micro sense, I try to work with themes in order to say a sentence sometimes, or I'll just say the sentence other times. And I try to connect those dots, themes, and then explicit, implicit, explicit in a disorganized way. And that's also like my dad. He like an absent-minded professor, kind of.
So, well, it's more so like, I guess, organized entropy in a way.
Right.
You know? What else were you listening to when you were growing up?
Shit, bro. A lot of shit. A lot of the radio. A lot of Nas. A lot of Frankie Beverly, Maze, Isley, shit like that. Damian Marley, Bob Marley. A lot of Fugees. All manner of shit. But mainly just things that were, excuse me, in that fucking like neo soul slash like jazz rap kind of vein.
Yeah.
A lot of different things, though. Like, my dad's a real big Wu fan. My mama, like, DMX. She, like, what's that shit called? Bone Thugs. Just all manner of shit.
Yeah.
She liked the game a little bit. So we was listening to a lot of different things. And then my cousins, they really got me hip to like a lot of trap music. Like they put me on the like the early Wayne tapes when we was young, the young 50 Cent, a lot of young Drake. And then that morphed into like the Chief Keef, the Young Thug, all of that I got from more so my cousins and like the people I was going to school with. So like I just really got a real like holistic love for this shit, for real.
I feel you. So you mentioned earlier that you were listening to kind of the underdog rap, mm-hmm. and also on another realm, listening to kind of like, I don't want to say the polar opposite because it's all under the same umbrella, but in terms of, you mentioned earlier interview that like you're trying to see what makes these artists cool.
Right.
Right? Were you doing that? Because with your music right now, it's very pinpointed, not only for a specific purpose, but for a very specific audience. Would you say, when you were looking at, okay, what is cool right now, was that more so of a mechanism so you can use to grow your exposure with the music, or did it come from a start of maybe insecurities in the start?
Neither. And I disagreed at my music for a specific audience. The reason why I was into what makes things cool is not what makes things cool, but what makes things sound cool in terms of delivery, in terms of inflection, in terms of how you say this word or how you string together this flow to where you reach this point number four from point number one.
Yeah.
That was what I was into. And it was more from like a aestheticism point of view where I was searching for like, what's the internal logic of beauty within this art form? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that enabled me to manipulate it beyond even an audience because like I'd be surprised by who listened to me very frequently. But then I don't be so surprised because I'm speaking from one, an honest place. And so anybody who got any kind of modicum of honesty in their life and their experience as a human on earth could tap in. And then from a place of like honest about like the nature of black youth and shit like this. And so like, it's such a multiple experience.
It's multifaceted.
Right, and so I can even capture one facet of one person experience in the entirety of somebody else's, or just 100th of one person experience and 99% of somebody, you know what I'm saying? That study is just for me to try to exist in more points within the middle of the Venn diagram between like everybody.
Because you draw a lot of influences, not only just from music, but from poets,
right?
From books, etc. So I wanted to ask you, because you're extremely multifaceted and you're a writer, which you attribute to magic,
yeah.
You're a scientist,
yeah.
You're a philosopher, and we can go on and on. But what made you choose music as the vessel?
I didn't. I didn't in that way. Like, whereas I chose music, that would kind of assume that I stopped science or I stopped philosophy. Or that the music is the vessel to enrich the study of humanity and of existence that the science, the philosophy, the reading, and the making music is for, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's one way I could tap deeper into myself and into like people I love, for sure. And it's a way that I can do stuff. I can turn, like music allowed me to turn the ether into the material, you know what I'm saying?
No, it definitely is.
Cheers, man. Let's see what this thing talking about. I can dig it.
So, you're from North Carolina, right?
Yes.
Born and raised?
Yes. I was born in South Carolina. My dad moved to North Carolina ahead of me and my mama, and that's when he started like working in programming. He didn't go to school for programming. He was a philosophy major. And my mama, she was like a nurse. She was like a 2-year degree nurse. So we waited on, he was waiting on us for a little bit till I was like 3. Then I moved to the east side of Charlotte, like off Albemarle Road, this apartment complex called Lake Point. Then I moved to another apartment complex, and then I moved to the crib that I basically grew up in the rest of my life, about 3, 4, or 5, you know.
So, why New York right now?
Why not? It's a lot of work here, you know what I'm saying? Like I was just saying on this song, like it's some shit to tour out here. It's a lot to get out here. And it really made me feel like I'm living in the future a little bit, where humanity is just looking in at itself. Like,
that's interesting.
And you know what I'm saying? I was telling a homie, like, sometimes New York is like, say, like Southerners is dumb. But like a lot of New York couldn't even like function without like the function of other humans type deal.
Definitely.
It's man looking at man. Whereas like where I'm from or where my family from is more like man looking at nature and then back at himself intermittently.
Yeah.
And it's a different experience from that. But it's an enriching one because you really get to the meat and potatoes of like, you know, what humans like, what their potential is and what they do with like their endowments just from themselves.
Yeah.
For sure.
One thing I want to get into, I don't know if I saw this in a tweet. I forgot where I saw it, but I remember.
That's good.
You like it?
That's good.
I think it was your elementary school teacher or middle school teacher commented about your writing at a very young age and said Mavi was a very gifted writer. I might have been seeing, I saw it somewhere. I don't know if it came from you, but I saw it somewhere. One thing I wanted to ask you, when going into writing at such a young age, right? Well, how old were you when you first started actually like writing, jotting things down?
I always wrote poems since I was like in like third grade, fourth grade, like these poems on my email from back then. But my first rap was probably about 13, 14.
13.
Yeah.
When you were writing at a young age, yeah. was that more of you documenting your experiences in life, or more so of you creating worlds to escape to?
It was more like, same as now, more analytical, where I was taking the whole of my life and the things that I had learned in my experience or at school at that point, you know what I'm saying, more so than anything else. And then, or like history a lot, like I wrote a poem about like slavery, black shit, like all type of shit. And so, like when I was super young. So it was basically me just trying to make, like, draw the lines between the dots, like history and shit, like in ways I could understand.
So you went to Howard,
mm-hmm.
and you are you're a neuroscience major in bio?
Minor in psych.
Minor in psych.
Yeah.
So coming from a STEM major myself, you're taught that things have to be accurate to the third decimal.
Right.
Right. So I come from engineering background. So if things aren't accurate to the third decimal, that building falls.
Right.
Or the car explodes.
Right.
Would you say being that detailed and analytical from the science field translated into your writing?
Yeah, but then kind of not, because also one thing I appreciate about science, like to the third decimal, 95th, 99th percentile, is because it kind of throws its hands up in the air and say that it's never going to be 100%. And there's something to that. And there's a reason for that. That's what the writing is, the 1%, you know, the 0.1%.
Yeah.
Even, 0.001% even. That's where, like, this shit could fall. And it was built to the third decimal, you know?
That's such an interesting way of looking at it. And another, Matt, so again, coming from an engineering background, for us, right, so when my parents first immigrated to America,
mm-hmm.
we saw science majors more of a means to survive, because for us, we thought of it as, here's a lucrative degree that's the quickest way to get you out of poverty.
Mm-hmm.
But, and in that, you forget the beauty of the science that you're doing. You brought up a very interesting point before, and I never thought of it before, because I always thought of, for instance, engineering as inhibiting creativity, almost, that engineering forces you to see things black and white. But from your perspective, it's actually the curiosity that drives science.
And it's all the color in between shit. Like, from a biological perspective, like taxonomy, where you distinguishing this green frog with 4 dark green spots on his back with yellow feet from this green frog with 3 spots on his back and yellow feet. Like, there's something artful to that. And the reason why we even want to be able to distinguish that, that's the same as like knowing why red and yellow is orange. I was going to say green. why red and yellow is orange and shit like that. Like, and then it's like being taught science from the perspective that science has answered all the questions is one way that you could really make your scientific discovery a moot point.
Yeah.
And like not, and the people who, like, once them people who teach you that all the questions have been answered, what they study it really show you that like not even a tenth or not even 1% of the questions have been answered.
There's a lot that we don't know, and there's a lot that we don't know that we don't know.
Right, and you gotta know everything it is to know what you don't know, and to know that you don't know it, you know?
Yeah, it's the curiosity that drives innovation.
Right, and the innovation will drive further curiosity.
Exactly.
Because it's gonna come with its own problems.
So is that, when you're a major in bio mm-hmm. and a minor in psych, mm-hmm. you're dealing with, I won't say imaginative world, but the world that we don't see versus the world that we do see.
Yeah, and I hate to make it, but hard and soft science. We can say that.
Yeah, hard and soft, hard and soft science.
Yeah.
And from my understanding, one of the goals behind that was you want to find consciousness in the body.
Right.
My question is, when we're dealing with hard and soft science, right? Something that's tangible and something that is hard for me to see.
Right.
And you're shifting between those two modes of thinking. Do you ever find yourself in scenarios where you might be thinking too much in the imaginative than the what's real?
Nah, because I'm hypercritical, and that's another thing from my father. Like, it's more so that the basis in having the asshole physics teacher that if you fuck up this, then, you know, he's going to be a total dick to you. Or having the asshole bio 1 teacher where if you don't know the difference between this worm and this worm cladistically, you're a dumbass. And then having, like, you know, some psych teachers where they willing to take logical steps that I'm not willing to take necessarily, or to draw conclusions that I'm not necessarily willing to draw. That's what allowed me to parse. And then vice versa, like when a biology teacher doesn't leave enough room for the non-physical or the non-apparent and give me pause. Because, you know, even the biological history of the world is super incomplete.
Exactly.
So, you know, it goes both ways.
So how, you've also said when it comes to your writing that you come to a place when you hit writer's block, it comes from you assuming too much because it's that curiosity that would drive the pen, correct?
Absolutely.
Here's one thing. When you're deconstructing assumptions, right? Mm-hmm. At least in the science world. So there's what we know, right? Mm-hmm. And there's what we don't know. But when we find out what we don't know, we have these new assumptions that become conclusions, right? So, like, for instance, if, again, I'm an engineer, so I'm going to put this in a physics problem.
Let's do it.
If I want to find out how much force I have to put on this cup for it to fall off the table, the first assumption I have to make is there's a force of gravity acting on the way of this cup. And then the surface tension of the table, we don't have to get in. So what I'm trying to say is that there are certain assumptions that are vital for the conclusions that you make.
Right.
So when you hit these points of writer's block, how are you able to pinpoint which assumptions that you think you're making to deconstruct?
I leave it all the way alone, because writing is not science. Science is humanity observing the laws that's established by God, period.
Yes.
Gravity is a law because gravity is a law. Like, gravity is self-evident.
Yeah.
When I try to be self-evident in writing, I'm doing it wrong. You see?
Yeah.
And those certain assumptions are sturdier than other assumptions. And then certain assumptions, certain new knowledges, right?
Yeah.
Will be always in line with certain old assumptions.
Yeah.
But they might make middle assumptions kind of wobbly.
Yeah.
So on the writing tip, I try to just go all the way back to zero. Like, I don't know how to rap, and I never wrote a rap song. Write your first rap song again, you know?
So it's like a continuous process of starting over.
Right. Because that's when I was most potent. When I was a baby, when I was uncorrupted just by the experience of having done this shit.
Mm.
And then processing my experiences of having done this shit through that fucking lens has created a lot of fun things for me, for sure.
How has juggling being a student with not just any major, it's neuroscience is a demanding major, yeah, but my major in bio. How have you been juggling that with becoming an artist?
Do my homework, go to class sometimes, don't go to class other times. Do my homework sometimes, don't do my homework other times. You know what I'm saying? Go to an interview, don't go to class, go to class, reschedule interview, things like that.
So you find a way to work around.
Yeah, got to. I got to.
Would you say that any working habits from school or from making music transfer to the other realm, or they kind of stay like your school habits are just your school habits and you're making music habit, making music habits stay in that realm?
I be having kind of poor habits as a student and as a musician though, in some ways. Like, it's definitely things I need to improve on in terms of consistency in both realms. So I'm kind of just like doing this when I can, doing that when I can, and doing my best the whole time. Just doing my best, let God do the rest. Just throw the balls in there and they land in my hands like 99% of the time.
What I wanted to ask you was, you have a very spiritual tone under to the music. When did you pick up, when did you get into spirituality like that?
Sorry, bro. When I did acid the first time. And I be telling some more of this, like, God don't work logically. God is a conundrum. Because, like, it's like a thing that, like, concept, group of concepts, group of laws that we squish into one conceptual thing, right? That's allowed to us by our experience as a human, or that by our five senses. Outside of that, you can't really give it to nobody else. That's why it ain't so scientific. Science, you can't really give to nobody else. You just got to believe each other. Kind of how God works too, you know?
Yeah, but also, like, I feel like the tendency is for people to kind of put God in a box, because when we're talking about something infinite and we're finite, it's hard to imagine about something negative infinity to infinity. So we kind of put God in a box and give him like these human attributes.
That's not what I do. I see God as the universal force of attraction, creation, and destruction, period. And put through a cosmic lens, is that where subatomic particles want to fill shells in a certain way based on attraction, where atoms want to fill their shells in certain ways with certain attractions, where chemicals want to make certain interactions. That's patternistic. Where celestial bodies have certain interactions that's consistent based on their mass and distance and all of this, right? Mm. And that's why everything don't really work out. I don't think God's job is to make everything good. Because good is less real than God.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So when we looking for God to be good, that's when it don't really work for us. God is the thing that's gonna make stuff flat, equilibrated. That's just the facts of this thing. That is a fact of this thing, though. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, man. No, I'm just amazed with, like, the way with words that you have, that, like, I'm just, like, processing everything.
But God is great, though. Don't get it fucked up.
God is great.
You got me here.
Now with the music. Mm-hmm. When did you start seeing, like, your first significant buzz around the music?
Probably I dropped this song, One Foot.
I love that song.
Yeah.
I love that song.
Love that song, too.
And that was, after that, you kind of saw...
Yeah, and then after that, I did, like, 12 singles. Like, 14, 15, if you count YouTube and stuff. And then I did Let the Sun, and that was, like, coming out party. By the time I was on single number 12 or 14 or whatever number it was, I knew like the song was going to be a thing. I didn't know what kind of thing. I'm in that kind of bag now. Like, I know my next thing is going to be a thing. I don't know what kind of thing. So that's an exciting feeling. But yeah, bro, that's really the size of it. Like, when I knew, like, even before that, though, like, I was doing okay. Like, I was, you know,
when did
tens of thousands.
So the singles, and my first introduction to you was Let the Sun Talk.
Mm-hmm.
And I was reading that you sat on that album
a year.
A year.
Yeah.
How did that feel sitting on like a body of work for a year, just trying to get it out, but not like things not falling in place?
Infuriating.
I can only imagine.
And like a certain shit would happen, like I would have certain beats on there for like a year. I wrote a year before it got was done, right?
Yeah.
And then another nigga would come and sample that sample and I would be blown, like just little petty shit. And so, yeah, but then it was for the best ultimately because certain, and it's like this now because I'm in that same kind of bag. Like my second album was supposed to be out, what, 4 or 5 months ago. So it's good because you start to hear the world, where the pieces of the world is missing in your mix. Like even like I don't listen to Let the Sun that frequently no more, but like Chiasma got the sirens that ended, and literally that came from I was listening to Chiasma at the crib, and it was 12 outside, and I was like, damn, that's mad pretty, and so when it came time to master, I was like, yo, just throw a siren at the end of that, and we'll end it on that, and then that would be the intro into the next thing, and so certain parts of it I just had to allow to happen, and the year was like my opportunity to do that looking back. In the moment, though, it was definitely not something I was happy about or satisfied with, for sure, at all.
But then it did. And then, but after, in the meantime, it was definitely infuriating. But it brought you to another realm in terms of the audience. One thing I don't want to dwell on "Let the Sun Talk" too much, just because there's other things, other new music I want to talk about. But taking it kind of back to science, there's this concept of inertia.
Right.
When objects resistance to velocity and change. Because when Let the Sun Talk, I remember seeing that you said that you didn't expect it to garner the attention that it did.
Right.
Do you, when you saw things blow up the way they did, for you, was it kind of like, oh shit, what the fuck is going on? Or were you kind of like rolling with the punches?
No, it's like, let's get to work.
I like that.
That's what you asked for. At the end of that shit, like, off Let the Sun, bro, I booked fucking, like, 8 shows dolo out of my email. Like, Houston, Oakland, L.A., Minneapolis, Boston, New York.
Yeah. Didn't you perform the train?
Yeah.
I remember seeing that.
That shit was fire. But, yeah. Like, shit like that, it was like, yeah, let's go. That's where I'm at now. Let's get it.
So it never became, like, this overwhelming thing for you?
No, only thing that be overwhelming me is like niggas be trying to like intentionally be aggravating to me.
That
I don't like. But beyond that, it's cool. Like, you know, niggas was listening to my music before. Like, and like me and my friends, it was a point where me and my friends were the only people listening to our music. You know?
Was that part of the kill switch?
Yeah. It was a time where it was just only us. And so it was a time where it was just only us and a few people. And it was a time where it was only us and a few more people. And it was a time where it was us. And enough people where we can't necessarily conceptualize how many of them, but it wasn't doing nothing materially for our life.
Yeah.
And then it was a time where it was more than we can conceptualize again, but it is doing something for our life. So that part, not too hard to wrap it.
I like the fact that for you it was more so of like, this is what you asked for, because it's more so of, it keeps you grateful.
Right.
It keeps you grateful because sometimes when you're chasing what you actually want in life, you have to go through these certain obstacles that make you feel uncomfortable. And it's always nice to sit down and be like, bro, like, this is part of it. Like, this is what you, this is, if this is what's going to take, it is what it is.
But it was like times where I would be in a studio, like, I hope they're not embarrassed. But it was like times where, like, I was in a studio, like, the first time I was in New York, I was in a studio, like, Sage and Mike. And we was doing a record or whatever. And I was, like, finna cry in there. Like, I had to just hold it together. You know what I'm saying? Just because, like, damn, nigga. Like, you way out here doing this thing that you like with these people you admire. And you making this slap. And you performing this way. And you did this well. Like,
so it's almost like a starstruck moment?
Not starstruck, but more like, damn, nigga. This is your feet, your body, your heart.
Yeah, being here. Like, you're here.
And I had that moment. I didn't, like, when my mama put, in New York is another place, it's a place where that happened a lot. Like, when mama put up to the show, like, and it was sold out, like, I cried again. Because it's like, I'm going to keep crying over this shit. No, you know what I'm saying?
No, it's just expressive gratitude.
Yeah, and I owe it to myself to keep making myself cry a little bit.
Definitely.
You know?
I wanted to quickly ask you, Killswitch,
Yeah.
How did that come together?
So Killswitch came together, two phases. So phase one was me meeting this kid named Makai Hampton. He was the first punk I ever met, first black alt kid I ever met. And he was like such a multiple human being. Like he was like he was on the football team, wrestling team, track team. And he was like a punk into like metal. Me and him was the first niggas to listen to Doom together. All right, we were into like Save Money heavy. So we were just into all kind of alternative.
Oh, Save Money?
Yeah.
For Chicago? Yeah, the Chicago scene's crazy.
We just got into, and that was like my ninth grade year. So 13, 14, like they were really going stupid then. And so like we was just into getting into all these like alternative ways of thinking about being ourselves while we was going to this hood ass school that I love.
Yeah.
And so that's phase one. And then phase two was me meeting Amir the King and Fresco, Scopac. They brothers. We met at this program called Studio 345, which was basically a place where they gave the kids a bus pass at the end of school. And you pull up to this like art space, not dissimilar to this. And they had like community teachers that came and taught musical production, film production, photography, screen printing, and graphic design. And so I met Amir and Fresco there just because like I was just so into how they was rapping. I just thought they was mad cool. Like them the only two names I'm a fan out for. And I think they're the best rappers still. And then phase three was me meeting my heart and soul Messiah, Micah. And we met in fucking 10th grade. In English class, and he raised his hand and said some shit. And I was like, damn, bro, you sound like you could be a rapper. He was like, yo, I'll be a rapper. And his band camp is still crazy. Like, he the best 15-year-old, 14-year-old, 13-year-old rapper ever. I would jack it. And so, basically, me meeting all three of them people, just making them interact and introduce each other. And Makai had already known Amir and Sko from middle school, which is just like crazy serendipitous. But it ended up just being so smooth and so familiar and so like defensive and so like competitive and fierce. Like it was the whole spirit of Charlotte that I was looking for and that I had in me from being raised there. And so they reflected something that like I could really build and grow within as a family. And it's still that for sure. Like they the most it's my comfort zone with them. I can write raps easiest with them. I could, you know.
For instance, for me, when I first moved to America, right, my immediate place was to look, all right, I need to find all the Arabic restaurants, I need to find the masjids, because it's a comfort zone for me, right? But sometimes, intentionally and unintentionally, I find myself outside my comfort zones. And when you find yourself outside those comfort zones, you bring in lessons that you otherwise couldn't from your own little space.
For sure.
Have you found that in your experiences?
Yeah, like, it was times where, like, all right, so I wasn't raised around, like, a whole bunch of white people at all, ever. And I ain't never really went to no white school, except, like, middle school. But then even my middle school was, like, 40, 50% black. So I found my black incubation, period. And my parents was intentional about that, taking us to drum circle, taking us to Kwanzaa celebration, Juneteenth every year, thing like this.
Yeah.
Where the black community in Charlotte was really apparent, evident. In high school, I took two trips that changed my shit. One was to, it was a circuit of trips that was all in the same program. One was to the Appalachian Mountains, one was to the Great Smoky Mountains, one was to Yellowstone National Park. All three of them shits, just being in nature, away from anybody who I thought was like, I'm not gonna shit on nobody, but like cool in the traditional sense that like what I would have attracted myself to otherwise. And then just being able to see the beauty and the entertainment, fun in these people, find some artistic rhythm in a completely uncomfortable, in the middle of the woods, up a mountain. You know what I'm saying? To look at a geyser and want to write a rap. And then that being encouraged by the program, that really alighted a lot of my, you know, central philosophy about art and science. And I'm grateful for that experience for sure. And that's something I was able to bring back to my nigga. And my niggas find themselves having similar experiences on an individual basis now when we're a little older, for sure.
Yeah, I think it's definitely important to venture out into the world outside of the bounds that you're comfortable from, because for me at least, it becomes, if I'm too intertwined with what I'm comfortable with, it becomes kind of like an echo chamber for me. So it's important for me to go out into places or into scenarios that I might not be comfortable, but also be able to grow and draw.
But my thing about being a nigga is sometimes trying to escape an echo chamber, not so safe. And 100%. The kind of ideas that be within the chamber, yo, shit that's within earshot, shit you don't even necessarily need to hear from humanity. Shit you don't need to see the balance of humanity in that way. So in that sense, yeah, but then in the other sense, like, I don't see myself sending my child to no white school type shit for that reason.
Yeah.
Because, like, you open yourself up to unnecessary harm. It's not my goal. I would be dumber before I'd be harmed than I ain't had to be, you know?
No, 100%. 100%. No. Because at the same time, I feel like it's important to, like, mix between outside the comfort zone, but also keep your own originality and understand where you came from.
Right. And you can lose understanding of that. Or not even lose it, but you can be stripped of that understanding even within certain. That's why I even got to go home from New York a lot, because it's a different way of life than what I'm used to. Not that I can't do it, but I need to still be good at what I'm used to. Yeah. Urgently.
Yeah, no, I feel you. Yeah. Because
it ain't been the best for us yet. We ain't seen our peak.
So I wanted to bring this up, right? I'm going to keep it real honest. So I'm Palestinian, right? Mm-hmm. The definition of a home for me is much more in the figurative than it is in the physical, because physically that was stripped away from me.
Right.
Right. In that, right, there are physical places that I attribute to home, but deep down inside, I know it's not home.
Right.
One of those escapes I went into was music, more specifically hip-hop.
Mm-hmm.
But also, I realized that you cannot go into a house and occupy a house that is not yours, because you would be doing the same to that house as others have done to yours.
Right.
So I kind of wanted to ask you, and it's a prompt, I don't want to ask you a specific question, I don't want to narrow the scope of your answer. Before I get into the new music, I want to ask you, because I'm sure people here are watching, non-black people, like such as myself, trying and wanting to get into community.
Right.
So I wanted to ask you, what's your opinion on non-black people navigating through black culture, whether it's interviewers, producers, artists, critics, etc.?
My thing is, on this, hip-hop is a community of struggle because of the socioeconomic and historical time period where it was invented.
Yes.
Because of some things about its invention, that's why it's able to seep into major exporters of black culture, right, traditionally.
Yes.
Your Oaklands, your Detroits, your Memphises, your Atlantas, your New York Cities,
yes,
Los Angeles, whatever. With that also, it seep into that for your Cubans, you know what I'm saying? Your French, London, everywhere on earth. Because it's like, there's a hegemony. It's not so simple as black and non-black. And I think the racial fucking politics of the United States flattens that necessarily.
Yeah.
In favor of white supremacy specifically.
Yes.
So that it can group other groups that, you know, in another country might be subjugated under that same rule into the population mass of whiteness, period.
Have you ever heard of the model minority?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That shit.
Exactly.
So as a Palestinian specifically, let's speak to that first and then we'll talk to non-black, period.
Yeah. By the way, how's the coffee? Be honest.
I love it.
I appreciate it.
As a Palestinian, this is your home. And I know this because my niggas who make hip-hop, shout out Jason Ajaki, but my niggas who really make some of the best beats, hip hop that I know, go to Palestine.
They go to Palestine?
Been to Palestine. Hug, love, it's your home. So, but it ain't everybody home though. If I can't come to your house, but you play hip hop all day at your house. If I can't meet your mama, it make it look a little different. But so boom, about this, about non-black people navigating this space. Be respectful.
Yes.
Like, for one, like how you go be if you in anybody's house. And I think black people get extended a real lesser kind of respect from the world. Where, because like, people can laugh with us and enjoy our company and enjoy our culture, but they don't gotta cry with us just cause they laugh with us. Like Vlad TV. Yeah, so, like, that's what I'm saying, like, certain people can bring, if you could bring 50 black men in and have them about to cry on your couch about telling they been shot and been shot at, you ain't never been shot or been shot at.
Yes.
But that's all you ask about. That make me feel different towards you. Even me, I'm a black person. I don't feel like I got access to all facets of black culture. I can't go to LA and wear any kind of hat I want.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
There's a lot of nuance.
I can't go to Chicago and just play all kind of music, but that's me being respectful. That's not even me being fearful of the consequences, because, you know, white people, they ain't scared of no consequences. And I got that kind of fearlessness. That's the only thing, that's the only thing I admire. So the audacity of the Caucasity. Yeah. I'm that audacious. We could take it anywhere. But at the same time, that's not my goal, even to step on nobody else's toes.
Yeah.
Some people don't care out of their own sense of fearlessness that even hip hop and other forms of black culture, because of where it come from, can gas up in your head, the fearlessness that it can instill in you.
Yeah.
Don't adopt that toward its own culture and feel like you got some kind of say or some kind of pull that you don't got. And over the internet, it's real easy to not have to face no consequences.
Oh yeah, because you're behind a screen.
Right.
But then you can go under like an alternative identity. No one's gonna know.
But in real life, if you step on somebody's toes, you might get stepped on. Oh, and I'm in the business of stepping on niggas who step on toes. That's what I like. Yeah. I'm a bully tester.
I like that.
Yeah. Like that. So, you know what I'm saying? Don't try to be a bully or no shit like that. And don't try to, and being a bully in every sense, like, don't try to talk over everybody. Don't try to like, not let nobody get no shine. Don't be talking down on shit that you can't do. Like, if you can't rap at all, you don't need to call no rap album trash, period, in my opinion.
Yeah.
If you can't rap at all, you can't call nobody trash. Yeah. I feel like I can rap real good.
Bro, and you're elite, bro. What do you mean real good?
And I won't call nobody trash. Yeah. I'll try to find something out of any rap song and be like, oh, that's hard, period. If I can't, I'll just be silent. Extend that kind of respect, because I extend it, and I don't really got no reason to, as a nigga who family done been through this and this and this and this and this,
yeah,
at the hands of some shit.
I think, not to get too topic, but yeah, I think my problem with music criticism is that it almost strips away of any beauty of it, because they look at it's looked at this weird frame that, like, oh, there's these objective criteria to what good music is, but it's more so that when you're looking from the lens of art, it's a completely subjective experience.
Yeah, and like, it's not even, like, all this credence isn't even given in all kind of industries. Like,
yeah,
how many movie reviews you ever watched in the last year? I mean, read. Watched or read, let's say that.
Read?
Yeah.
Honestly, I read Tenet before I watched it because I wanted to know if it was good. But that one.
One. Adam Sandler probably get 2 out of 10 on Rotten Tomatoes every movie.
Yeah.
Me and my girlfriend in real life, and actively be enjoying the fuck out of Adam Sandler movies. Yeah. And I'm sure them niggas will be giving him a 2 out of 10 do too.
Yeah.
Like the same way, like, if you cracking a smile during the Adam Sandler movie, you can't say it's a bad movie. If you bop your head one time to a Future song, you can't say it's a bad song. If you can't bop your head at all to a Future song, maybe you don't need to listen to it. That don't mean that you got some kind of shit to say about a Future song.
Yeah.
You can't, I objectively can't make no Future song. And certain, in a lot of cases, the people who the most polarizing to the critics be real deep in a bag you can't even access. Them be the ones that niggas really want to hop out and say, oh, this trash, or this is this, or this is that. Well, you won't even go over there. If you've seen Future in real life, or you've seen
Oh, you will not say shit.
Not even not say shit, you won't even go over there.
Yeah.
These niggas be living in LA. If you say that such and such LA rapper is asking, you won't even drive over there. Shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
Maybe if you go over there, bro, I became a fan of O3 Greedo, hearing him and watching people dance to him at a party in LA in a backyard of Inglewood. Context fucking matters.
Yeah.
With zero context, you got zero access. And you really just doing a fucking public masturbation. Like, don't demonetize. You're just doing public masturbation.
Oh, there's no monetization. Don't talk your shit.
You know what I'm saying? You really just jerking your dick in public, bro.
Yeah.
If you really think, like, you know what I'm saying, with zero context, zero access, zero experience, your shit matters. And regardless of how big your bandwagon is or how big your platform you feel you is, and that legitimize your shit. Look, if you're a movie critic, right, and 100,000 people read each one of your criticisms, are you giving Adam Sandler 2 out of 10s? 100 million people watch Adam Sandler. Yeah. So if we doing it based on that as a qualification, you still outside.
Yeah, no.
You know what I'm saying?
Bro, I would go down this pigeonhole of a topic, but we can sit here for hours. So one thing I wanted to ask. Two.
Yeah. End of the earth.
So the world ended.
Mm-mm. It's not a time, it's a place.
What's that all about?
Well, the end of the earth is about, like, you know how Buddhists say, like, end of desire, end of suffering?
Yeah.
It's about that. Also, the earth, it's a bunch of shit. So, 222 first. It's February. February 28 days. That's the lunar cycle.
Yeah.
The sun is number one in supreme mathematics. The moon, number two. Lunar cycle month, 222. And it's an angel number, so it's cute. So, the end of the earth, though, is about, and it's my second baby. And then the end of the earth is more so about, like, first, number three. So, one is the sun, two is the moon, three is the earth. Earth okay. is the baby.
Okay.
This is the end of me as a baby, first. I'm all the way fully grown. I ain't going back now.
Yeah.
Number two, it's the end of earthly desire as the end of suffering. Not in the strict sense, but in the sense that, like, bro, I grew into a place where I can do for myself. To the point where the things, the shoes, the Jordans that I won in the seventh grade, I bought them. And it's really like three pairs.
Yeah. But you bought them. It's an achievement in itself.
Right.
Yeah.
And so my achievements that was based around that insecurity that I felt, they done been quelled. And the desire. And then it's about my home, which is my whole earth, my whole environment, flipping on me. Also, not flipping on me like the people. Like,
yeah.
I'm the mayor. But
you are.
I'm absolutely the mayor. But more so, like, it's getting violent there.
Yeah.
My home is at a crossroads that's driven by a lot of cultural factors. Whereas a black city is going to have to come into an identity that ain't been able to be kept or sustained because of systematic destruction of black communities in the 60s and 70s
yeah.
in Charlotte specifically. So a lot of that blowback is coming in the form of increased gun violence, increased murder, increased, you know what I'm saying? And so it's about me growing, period, into all of those things, into my, out of my earthhood as my father and my mother baby, out of my desires in terms of the immediate, I fed myself, yeah. out of hunger, out of earthly desire. And then out of an Eden. And earth is our Eden. We ain't know that yet, so we gonna fuck it up beyond repair. But it is that. And out of that safeness, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Presumed safeness.
There's an underlying concept behind it.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of recording it, what was the process like? Like, was it more so, did you have this concept, flesh out concept going in, or was it more so of picking it apart and fully realizing the picture you were painting?
So at first, I was just going to call it Waiting for Shango, because that's my next album. And then I was going to call it, what was the other shit? Oh, I was going to call it Just Because I Love You. But I landed on End of the Earth because a lot of reasons. The lyrical thing that pointed me to choose End of the Earth was on the second song, 1,000 Miles, it ends. I could walk to the end of earth, I get there, still hear the screams. And that's just like on some, yeah. But that was it. And then it just drove me into listening to everything, and I added two more songs just to fit concept, and I realized things about what I was writing. And you'll see when you hear it.
This is recorded before the EP drops for context.
Yeah.
If there's one thing you want people to come out of the EP with, a concept to understand, what would it be?
It's the end of the earth as we've been shown it. Why has supremacy been so diagonal? We gotta get to a more circular mode. Like, acknowledging the equivalent positive and negatives on each end, and the infinite routes to get around the circle. It's the end of the earth as we've been shown it. The unsustainability of the global hegemony, super loud and apparent in our faces. And any way you wanna look at it, population dynamics, poverty rates, coronavirus pandemic, shit not working.
Yeah.
It's the end of the earth if we've been shown it.
We were talking about assumptions before, right? I want to test out an assumption real quick. Mm-hmm. So, is valid or invalid? An EP is indicative of a major album or a major project on the horizon that's not done yet.
No. Not done yet. I got so much major projects done. Ugh.
So there's more to come after.
Oh yeah.
In terms of the release of the EP, is there anything else releasing with it? Merch?
Yeah, some merch. Yeah, just some merch. Maybe a poster.
Does it feel weird dropping in the middle of a pandemic in terms of like not being as mobile as you would before?
Yeah, but also no, like I really only got to tour one project ever in my life.
Yeah.
And Charlotte's not really a place that's so like into letting young artists perform consistent venues around the city like Atlanta or LA or not New York. Or like, yeah, New York, DMV even. Like I got a lot of my early performance experience at Howard and around DC and the DMV. But because of that, like my first real like live experience, the thing that was connecting the dots of why, the reason why to do this shit being evident through experience in the God way.
Yeah.
That was only around Let the Sun. Mm. So we going kind of back to our old mode, but Lord willing, we'll be able to tour this shit. And I'm gonna do like little mini, I'm trying to get like band shit together.
Yeah.
So I can still feel the presence of other people and the energy of other people through the music without necessarily having to draw a whole audience. So I'm trying to experiment a few different things, but it is different though than the last one for sure for that reason.
To wrap things up, I saw in a tweet that you discussed sobriety. So I wanted to ask, how are you feeling?
Good, bro. My brain's at the front of my head.
I like that, man. I like that.
I think I said, what's the name? I said it in another interview. It's like, my brain's in a vat of water now and not a vat of soda pop.
So it was fizzling before?
Yeah, I was on the road to be burnt out. And I went too long without a break too hard. And my body started answering and responding in kind. And I needed to respond back to my body like, hey, stay with me now.
Yeah, I think it's important to kind of recognize your body's signals, because we live in this hustle culture, but the problem that I find with that is that it's like, bro, we're fucking human beings. I'm not a machine.
Right.
So you need your rest periods.
Right.
So I feel like once you feel things fizzing up out there, it's kind of a sign for you to step back and reflect on things.
And then also, marijuana, kids. First, two things.
Okay.
Marijuana is a gateway drug, kids.
So you would say it's a gateway drug?
Don't let the cool kids fool you. Marijuana is absolutely a gateway drug. But one, it is not a gateway drug into like George Bush, like, hey, don't smoke weed, kids. But I'm saying, the neurocognitive experience of being high and the cost-benefit analysis of it being not that harmless,
yeah,
is definitely a paradigm that could be taught to you by marijuana and extended to other drugs that have higher costs and less benefits for a fact. That's just a regular fact. And number two, while you may not be able to form physical dependence to marijuana, I wasn't sweating and shit, but I had a damn mental and psychological and habitual dependence on it, where after doing something hard or daunting or taxing, I go and smoke some weed. Or
because of the reward system.
Right. And so you don't want to hijack your reward system, because things that you should enjoy, if you're smoking before them every time, who to say you really enjoying them? Or like, I just needed more access to my brain and my experiences on a day-to-day, so I could feel like I was here for it.
Yeah.
For sure. And the memory loss go with that too, you know?
Before closing, I want to go back to the EP real quick. Mm-hmm. Again, I haven't seen shit. I don't know a track list. I don't know anything. But assuming, depending on when this comes out, maybe after the EP, is there a specific song that when you wrote it, you were like, this is it, in the EP?
The first one. Time Travel. Absolutely.
Was that like a one-go thing? Or like...
Yes.
I feel like instant inspirations of a creativity produce like the best works. Would you agree?
Yeah, because I mean, it's like a scribble versus like an etching.
Yeah.
And you want to scribble when you're rapping. That's where the humanity come out, you know?
Production-wise.
Yeah.
What sounds you have on there? Which producers did you work with?
So we got Aloysius on two tracks, Nephew Hesh on one, Isaac or Eyesight on one, and Keem the Cypher on one. So I think we got four producers over five tracks, like 15 minutes.
Sonically speaking, was there a turn away from Let the Sun Talk?
Yeah, everything is a turn away. Let the Sun Talk, we was a year old when it came out.
Yeah.
I'm open to the parallels being drawn between Let the Sun and everything else I make for the rest of my career, because that's going to happen.
Yeah.
At the same time, I'm not itching to make another Let the Sun, because that shit, like, honestly, bro, like, not on no ego shit, but, like, it's not my best. And it was, like, easy route kind of rapping, like, verse, beat,
yeah.
Verse, beat. And I wanted to explore more structure, more riveting kind of instrumentalism, deeper, more experience-driven content, everything. I wanted to...
I feel like when people, the first impression of an artist, they latch onto that and they don't understand the concept of like artistic growth, because it would be unfair for you to be offering a copy of yourself.
They gonna understand it. This shit hard, bro.
I'm not denying that.
This shit is hard. Like, I can't cap. My next two shits is crazy, bro. Like,
so when you finish the EP, you can sit back and be like, all right, this is...
I run that shit, and I'll be like, damn, this shit is hard. Like, I listen to my own voice for 15 minutes. It'd be like, damn.
And that's another thing. Yeah. Like, I feel like when you create something, it's hard to withstand yourself.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Hate it. I hated it at first. I had to grow... And that's why I did more shit with my voice, too, because, like, also, like, the rap voice shit, that shit lame as hell. I be trying to rap like how I talk now, like, more and more. That's the best way to do it.
Conversational.
Not even conversational in lyrical content, but conversational in delivery. Not even conversational in delivery. I mean conversational in, like, adopting the same tonality, the same dynamicness when I'm trying to express an idea that's coming to me from the ether, one building block at a time, as when I'm saying a pre-planned rap. That's like mastery.
Yeah.
Know?
What else is next for you?
Man, more action, more excitement. I'm fucking with you. Whole lot of mob shit. Shit, I'm gonna graduate at some point in life.
You're not stressing out in terms of a date.
What?
Like for next graduating. Like, are you concerned with, like, I need to finish on time, or when it happens, it happens?
I mean, they need to keep my scholarship going.
Okay.
I'm gonna milk it.
Yeah.
They saying I had to do it in 16 or 8 semesters. We gonna work around it. We gonna pull some strings. But beyond that, I'm not pressed, because also, like, I feel like, boom, high school senior year, like, I probably ain't learned nothing.
Yeah.
I probably just did a lot of shit. Or did, like, enough shit to, like, keep my good GPA and shit like that.
Yeah.
And I ain't learned as much. I don't want to take that from me in this experience when it's so much. Like, I'm taking Zulu right now. Like, I really, like, I'll skip pre-cal on some shit. Because math, I could teach myself math. But I miss Zulu class. My teacher's like a dynamic man. He teaches all sorts of things about culture, being African, being American, the cultural differences, the syncretism between ideas, all of this shit. If I miss that, I feel like I failed. I'm wasting my money and my time and wasting his time. I want to do that as little as possible.
As a respect for his time.
And a respect for his willingness to share.
Yeah.
Like learning independently on your own time, grown time, outside of the context of school is like, that's the idea that's frightening to me.
Yeah, 100%.
That's kind of why it's important for me to not fail in school.
Yeah.
Or to not fall up, not be a rapper student. Be a regular student. Nobody knows shit about me in class, shit like that.
Just a regular dude.
Regular nigga. I'm a regular nigga all the way around. That's 100%. One of my most important governing philosophies, nigga. Like, you not worse than nobody, but you not better than nobody. Nobody.
It keeps the engines going.
You got to. You fail. Like, you fail God. Like, you fail the gift of humanity, the gift of this big brain, the gifts of evolution.
Yeah.
You fail the gifts of your family who done been in different places and ain't been able to be in certain places that you had. You fail being better than niggas. And you fail them same things. You fail God, your family, and the history, them not being able to be where you at by feeling worse than niggas. So I just be trying to be regular.
Just keep it going. But man, I appreciate you coming through. I appreciate you sitting down, giving me this time. Where can people find you?
Shit, Mavi for Mayor. You could type in Mavi. Yeah, I'm lit. Yeah.
Hey, and EP coming out?
EP coming out 2/22. It's easy to remember.
2/22. All right, my guy. Cheers to that.
Man, cheers, man. Cheers, love, man. Yeah.
All right.
Fuck shit. No, hold shit.